tries to roll over my bones. When sorrow comes to steal the joy I own. When brokenness and pain is all I know, I won't be shaken. No, I won't be shaken. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love.
Good morning. We have a lot of red, white, and blue this morning. If you want to go ahead and stand. We're going to open with a scripture from the Psalms this morning. Psalm 100. Make a joyful noise to the Lord, all the earth. Serve the Lord with gladness. Come into his presence with singing. Know that the Lord, he is God. It is he who made us, and we are his. We are his people and the sheep of his pasture. Enter his gates with thanksgiving and his courts with praise. Give thanks to him and bless his name. I'm going to read that one more time. Enter his gates with thanksgiving and his courts with praise. Give thanks to him and bless his name. For the Lord is good. His steadfast love endures forever, and his faithfulness to all generations. Lord, we thank you for the freedom that you've given us. The freedom that just having you living in our hearts, you give us freedom, Jesus. But the freedom you've given us in this country to worship you freely on a Sunday morning or any day of the week, Jesus, we can gather and not worry. We can gather as one body to praise you and worship you. Let your hand and your blessing be upon this service, Jesus. In your name we pray. Amen.
Does anyone have a testimony you'd like to share this morning?
We're finally back. It was a really good couple weeks with John's parents. We only get to see them a couple of times a year, so that was a really blessed time. But the last couple of days, Hadley started feeling really sick, and we traveled home with two sick kids because Judah started feeling sick. And it was a lot of John driving and me just sitting in the back trying to console them and make them feel better. We took them to the doctors, and they had double ear infections, but that was Tuesday. And by Thursday, Judah was not getting better. He was getting worse. So they sent us to Children's because he was not eating and that's not usually a problem for him. And he was not having wet diapers. When we got there, they said, we'll give him some fluid and see, you know, if he turns this around on his own. He wasn't really having a lot of trouble breathing at that point. So they were just kind of iffy on whether they were going to keep him or not. But when he still wouldn't eat after like 5 hours, they were like, let's just admit you guys and watch and see how things are going. And through the night, it took a turn for the worst. And he was having a really hard time breathing. So he ended up in the PICU. And there was a point where he was just crying nonstop. And we were tired and he couldn't eat. And we had been asking a lot for prayers, but I just kind of had to lay hands on him and, like, ask God to come and, like, just flood our room and let us know that he was going to be okay. And when the doctor had come back in, John said, you know, my parents are thinking about flying in here. And we finally got some, like, reassurance, like, no, he'll be okay. This is just, like, on his own time when he's going to turn it around. But as I was praying for him, they were trying to get blood work and said they could not do it until his heart rate went down. And as I was praying over him, all of his stats started to drop and come down. And they were able to come and get his blood work and check his platelets, and everything came back normal. And honestly, just from that point on, he really started to turn around. He turned the corner and started to feel a lot better. And we went up to the regular floor that next morning, and he got discharged the same day. So we're just really grateful that he's okay. We're grateful for all the prayers and everybody who reached out to us, and we're just really, really happy to be back.
Well, I'm sure everyone knows that we're having this benefit sale on Thursday evening, and we were very blessed because a lot of people donated a lot of stuff. And when we first started, I was just going to have it in the garage, but we've outgrown the garage, so we're moving out into the driveway and up into our yard. But what I need is some help, because I thought maybe I could handle it, or some, you know, Barb and my husband could handle it in the garage, but we need some help just kind of watching things out in the yard. So if you're interested, please come and see me, and I would really appreciate the help. And I do thank everyone that has donated items. I think this will be a great sale. And come and shop. There's lots of shopping to do. Thank you.
Does anyone else have anything to share this morning?
Probably not everybody knows, but in the last month we have been great grandparents twice. And
And the first one was born the 24th of May. The little fella is doing great. The second was born June 24th. It's a little girl, and she had a few problems. She had to stay a few extra day, but God is good. She's home now, and everything's doing fine. Also, I want to mention our one grandson plays baseball. And he's played baseball since he's been so high. Graduated this year. He's on a travel team. Last Sunday night, he was up to bat. And a boy was of the other opposite team was pitching a ball about 93 miles an hour, they said, when it hit him. When it hit him, he automatically went down. But thank God he was wearing a chin guard. And in that chin guard, there is a big dent. He has a few stitches and a little swollen face, but he's going to be fine. We have so much to be thankful for, because just a few little, less than a fraction of an inch, it would have been a whole different story. So the only thing I can say, we love baseball, but that chin guard really saved him.
Are there any others this morning?
If you wanted to say something, you missed your chance. So next week, hold on to it for next week. Glad to have you all here this morning. It was looking light, but of course we are blessed to have people that come in late. So thank you for that. We're just glad to have you. Come late, come in your jammies, just come however you got to come. We want to see you here in the morning. So we're blessed to have all of you and thankful for you. As we kind of step into a moment of prayer and prepare our hearts for that. There's a couple of things, if you have your prayer sheet, that I want to point out and just let you see so that you can kind of have it in your mind and be prepared for and just be thinking about. One is, if you go to the backside, you'll see our missionaries. Two of our missionaries right now, both by the name of Dan, are really, really fighting some good fights right now. Dan Holbrink is fighting for the refugees that are coming out of Ukraine and down into Romania. So be in prayer for him as he works that, and he takes supplies and brings them up to the border and grabs refugees and brings them back to their place and helps them get on their feet. Like, so Dan's doing such a great job. Dan is a man that does not allow things. Like, he doesn't allow himself to be still, if that makes any sense. So Dan's always busy, and whether that be physically working around the house or doing ministry, whatever the case may be. So he's he found that ministry's tough in a moment like this. Give you an idea what's going on for them. They all have been given by the Romanian government, they've been given pills, that in the event that there is nuclear war, they take the pill and it reduces the risk of radiation poisoning and things that would hit them. So that's kind of the reality that they live in. I know gas is expensive, but at least you don't have your nuclear fallout pill, right? You know, like life could get worse. So that's kind of the reality that they have at this moment. And he's ministering in the midst of that to these people and bringing them closer to Christ. And then also Dan Rojas, which... Leanne was good enough to share about the benefit sale, is actually all going to Dan Rojas, who's fighting against human trafficking. So be in prayer for Dan Hurlbrink and Dan Rojas as they do their work and they continue to seek to rescue people out of pretty desperate situations, and still desperate, just different situations. Be in prayer for that, if you would. Another one that I would encourage you to be in prayer for is the Varner family and the Kale family. They lost a very close loved one this past week, or week before last, so or this past one. So just be in prayer for them as they continue to walk through that difficult road and the pain that comes along with that, if you would. And then, of course, if you'd continue to remember the Beloits as they kind of get back into the groove of things and life and all the stuff that's going on. So just kind of continue to remember those things as we pray. But of course, I think we have some birthdays, if I'm not mistaken. I know that I think it's Leah's birthday, Leah Kirkpatrick's birthday, and Nolan. So I thought, I said, oh, is it Sam's birthday tomorrow? It's Sam's birthday tomorrow. Sam Heller, H-E-L-L-E-R. So, yeah, we're going to put you on there for tomorrow. So come up. We'd like to pray over you. I thought I saw Nolan, but maybe not. Did I not see Nolan? Huh? A tractor pulls. Sometimes things just matter more. So, yeah, tractor pulls are a good time. Let's just be honest. All right, so that's where they're at. But if you wouldn't mind coming up, we'd love to pray over Sam. Did we miss anyone else? Have we missed anyone else? No? Come on up. We're going to pray over Sam this morning and ask God to bless her the way she's been blessing to us. So. You don't have to know Sam to pray for Sam, so you can come up if you want. Even if you're like, oh, I don't know Sam. Come up anyway. So. All right, let's go before the Lord and bring Sam to him. So, Lord, we are thankful for this young lady that you have brought into our lives, and we are blessed beyond measure by her. Lord, you have been so good to us, and you've been you're putting that on display in Sam. And so we thank you for her spirit. We thank you for her willingness to grow and learn about you. We thank you for the way that you have created in her a desire to serve and a desire to lead and a desire to grow. Lord, you have just really created in Sam a beautiful spirit, and we thank you for it. I pray that you would continue to build her up, that you would continue to encourage her, continue to make her more like yourself in all things. I do ask that this next year would be the absolute best year that Sam has ever had, that you would give her strength, that you give her wisdom, that you would give her peace, that you would give her discernment in the ability to know when to speak and when not, and to when to act and when not to. Just give her that insight so that she may live a life that is fruitful and wise in a generation of people that live unfruitfully and pretty foolish. So I pray that, Lord, you would make her a standout among her peers, as you already have. And I would continue to ask for Leah Kirkpatrick. We are so thankful for her and her spirit and the fire that you've created in her. We thank you for the friendship that she has forged with my children and the way that they just love being around her and the encouragement that she is to them. And I pray for the Kirkpatricks as they raise her up, that they would have wisdom and strength and peace and that they would be able to shepherd her in such a way that it would sanctify them and it would sanctify her and that she would move closer to relationship with you as her Savior and she would choose you as her own. We thank you for that. We just ask that this next year be Leah's best year. I also want to lift up to you, Nolan, the same prayer, Lord, the best year that Nolan's ever had. Give him a supernatural helping of patience as he lives in a family. Give him a supernatural helping of wisdom and just let him be wise and strong beyond his years and able to fight off the predations of Satan in this world. We just ask, Lord, that you would keep him safe, that you would make him strong, that you would give him the ability to chase after all the things that you have for him to chase after. We love you, Jesus, and we are so thankful for all that you do for us. In your name we pray. Amen. All right. Our little folk, they're free to head to their classes and their spots. What else do you play? Like, I feel like every now and then there's just a new instrument that's in our life. So, all right. Do you guys remember ska? Do you remember this? It was like punk rock with brass instruments. You know what I'm talking about? Anyone here remember that? Was it just me? Okay. Yeah, it was short-lived for a good reason because it was just garbage. But that made me think of that a little bit. I'm like, oh, maybe we'll start a church ska band and, you know, fall into your relevancy. What? It was garbage, right? Why would we do that? You know, so, all right. Today is the exercise of gifts. So 1 Corinthians chapter 14, if you got your Bible with you. If you don't, there's a hardback black Bible right in the seat in front of you. Go ahead and grab that. If you don't own a Bible, I'd encourage you to keep that one. It's just a gift from us to you. And we'd love to have you have the Word of God in your hand. And you can you can hold on to that. So the exercise of gifts, 1 Corinthians chapter 14. Is where we're going to start today. Just to give you a heads up, I'm glad that things kind of, the way the service rolled out, because sometimes we'll have like 10 minutes of testimony, which is awesome, except it just kind of puts me 10 minutes behind. Today, normally on a normal Sunday, I've got 7 to 9 pages of notes I want to work us through. Today, I've got 11. So just to let you know that, like, I'm going to try and get through it quick, and Amy's looking at me like, you best not, but I do. So listen, last week was shorter, so it evens out, right? So anyway, that's where we're at. But 2 weeks ago, we started in chapter 12, where the Apostle Paul got into the idea of the endowment of gifts or the giving of gifts, that God has given all of us different gifts. And we are a very diverse people. Would you agree with that? Like, not racially in this room, we're not that diverse, but we're probably, I would guess, if I was like, who here has Irish descent? Who here? One? Come on. Who here is of German descent? Put your hand up. That's all of us. So yeah, we're not that diverse here in this room. And the Italians in the room, got a couple of those? Yeah. You're Spanish, aren't you? Yeah. So anyway, I was like, Viola was from Italy, wasn't she? And now I got it mixed up. It's basically the same place. So anyway, and Arnie's like, and I'm going to spit in his coffee later. So you know, we're a pretty diverse people in regards to the giving of our gifts. Right, that we all have a very diverse gift set given to us by the Lord. And in chapter 12, we really saw that God gave gifts to the church to maintain the unity of the church. That the gifts weren't given to divide us, but rather to unite us. In the same way that your body, each member of your body has a different function, so does the gifts that God has given to the church for the unity of the body, to bring it together. And we have a diversity of capacity. We have a diversity of usefulness. Not every gift is as useful as every other gift. And so we see this diversity in our giftings. All useful, but definitely not equal. And we see, and this is where a lot of times we'll see jealousy and strife come up, that we don't see, I think all gifts are equally important, but they aren't equally useful. Does that make sense? You follow that? So this is where a lot of times we see jealousy and strife come up, and where people begin to think, since I can't do this, I'm not necessary. And that's not true. You're equally important, just your usefulness looks different. And to not exercise for that reason is a poor reason. So I feel like, you know, that chapter 12 was kind of written to cut that idea out, that you aren't useful to the body. So that's chapter 12, geared towards the giving of gifts. And then chapter 13, we really had the chance to walk through correcting the bad exegesis or the bad understanding that we have of 1 Corinthians 13. If you've ever heard the love chapter of the Bible spoken at a wedding, love is patient, love is kind. You've heard that, say yeah, you have. Right. The context of that passage is not marital love. The context of that passage is letting love lead you in giving your gifts, right? That when I exercise my gifts, whether that be the ability to speak or whether that be the ability to share, whether that be the ability to work among people, you know, what or teach or whatever gifting I have, however I use that, if I don't let love be the leader in that, if I don't do it because I love the people that I'm serving, then it's of no value. And so he said, if you want to see your gift have value, you need to love first. And that was the context of chapter 13. And it brings it, it actually gives your gifts exponentially more value when you add love into it. And so it doesn't matter how great your gift is, it has no value without love. And now in chapter 14, we're going to see the regulation of the giftings and how he has brought order to the way that we use our gifts. And this chapter is an important one, it's a big one. It's like 40 verses long. But I'm going to try and knock it out this morning. If it gets to where it just goes, it's going to go obscenely over, I'll stop and we'll split it. Okay? Like, I'm not going to because one of the points I'm going to have to make if I get to it this week is don't overdo it. So we'll see if I can respond to my own teaching. All right. 1 Corinthians chapter 14, let's buckle up and get working. All right, verse 1, pursue love and earnestly desire the spiritual gifts, especially that you may prophesy. Now, push pause for a second, let's define a term. When he talks about prophecy, what he's speaking of is kind of Old Testament prophecy, which is a person came who spoke the words that God had spoken, right? God would speak to him, he would speak God's word. We think, tell the future, right? He's talking about speaking the word of God. That's the context in which he's using this, right? Because listen, for the Bible isn't written yet. It's being written, right? The Apostle Paul is currently writing this thing down. Does that make sense? So we didn't have the word. Listen, who here has the word of God on their phone in their pocket right now? That's not how it worked for them, right? They didn't have the iPhone back in Israel, right? So they didn't even have a paper Bible. The Bible lived in the synagogue and the New Testament was being written. So when he's talking about prophecy, he's talking about we are speaking God's words to you because no one had it in their hand. Does that make sense? So it's not telling the future. It's speaking God's word to people, mainly the gospel of Jesus Christ. For one who speaks, in verse 2, for one who speaks in a tongue speaks not to men, but to God, for no one understands him, but he utters mysteries in the spirit. And on the other hand, the one who prophesies speaks to people for their upbuilding and encouragement and consolation. The one who speaks in a tongue builds up himself, but the one who prophesies builds up the church. So here's the temptation. And we're all guilty of this. We've seen the gifts of God, the gifts of the Spirit, so misused that we're afraid to try, right? That we're afraid to engage with these things because we've seen them poorly used. And honestly, let's just shoot straight. When we see them used, it's weird, right? Right? It's just strange. So we're so afraid of using them that, but people misuse stuff all the time, right? People misuse pharmaceuticals. Does that make them all bad? Some of you are yeah, kind of. No, yeah. All right, people misuse guns. Does that make a gun bad? People misuse hammers. Does that make hammers bad, right? Just because it's been misused doesn't mean that we should avoid it. In fact, the argument Paul's trying to make is that we should use them more correctly. That we should desire to engage with these giftings that God has given us correctly so that we can overcome those who are using them poorly, right? And so he's trying to bring us to this place where we're willing to engage with the gifts that God has given, both in giving and receiving them. Now, the danger is, and I think where we fall into temptation, is to become preoccupied with certain gifts of the Spirit. And this is why I think what Paul is really trying to get to the heart of is we get this preoccupation with these big sign gifts of God, right? And if we are more preoccupied, if you get nothing else out of today, this is it for you, right? Do not become more preoccupied with the gifts of the Spirit than you are with the fruit of the Spirit. That the gifts of the Spirit are going to one day pass away. They'll one day cease. The fruit of the Spirit will carry on into eternity. You should care more about displaying the fruit of the Spirit: love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. You should desire those far more than the gifts. Amen? Amen to that? So if we're going to be preoccupied in something, let it be the Spirit of God bringing his fruit out in your life rather than the sign gifts, okay? Because we can get very preoccupied with these things. And if our gifts isn't leading to the fruit, then it's not a gift any longer. And we aren't investing in things that lead into eternity. We're investing in things that will cease one day. And I'm going to make the argument, in many ways, in many spaces, they have already begun to pass away. He didn't put a timeline on it, but we're watching these things. It's just the regularity and the necessity of them is just decreasing, right? And that's a good thing. That's okay, right? So here's the understanding. So in the context that the Apostle Paul was speaking, and in the context that he was teaching right here, the Apostle Paul traveled from essentially Rome, Italy, down through Western India, most likely somewhere in that ballpark, down to Egypt and the top part of Saudi Arabia. They didn't all speak the same language. Like, there wasn't a common tongue. It's not like everyone spoke Aramaic and everyone spoke Hebrew and everyone didn't speak, you know, Greek. Like, there wasn't a common language. And even within languages that were similar, there were dialects that were different. So everywhere Paul went and everybody he spoke to talked a different language. And yet, he shared the gospel with all of them. How? Well, because the Spirit of God gave him the ability to speak to them in such a way that they would understand. Right? Like, there's no other way to see it than Paul was able to through the Spirit of God. So that is when that was his gifting, and he was able to come to them and speak in the language that they would understand. Today, if you go on a mission trip, I will guarantee you this, you'll run into people that speak English. There are very few places on the planet that you won't. So you have a person whose spiritual gift is knowing those multiple languages who can interpret for you. Thank God for them, right? If you've ever been to other countries, you sure are glad that someone there talks the language, right? And so what we're seeing is this gift drop down in its necessity because the world is shifting. And what happens is many times we desire the gift more than we desire the giver. Does that make sense? We have a rule in my house. Some of you men may have this rule in your house too. If you don't, you should implement it. It's an important rule. When Amy goes to the store, she has to bring me a treat. It's just a rule we have in our house that when she goes to the store, she needs to bring me back something, right? And I'm like a dog. Like, that's like, you know, like I she walks in the door, I'm like, what'd you bring me? You know, like, so this is how it works in our home. And now, I will be far more heartbroken if she didn't come back than if she forgets the treat, right? Like, I want her to come home, and I want the treat, right? You know, but if she doesn't come home, I'll be heartbroken. If she forgets the treat, I'm like, oh, okay, and I go on with my life. Does that make sense? I desire Amy more than the gift, right? And so this is many times how we come at the Lord, that we desire his gifts more than we desire him. So as we continue to move forward, we defined prophecy, that he's talking about speaking the word of God, mainly the gospel. What a great gift that is. And I'm going to make the argument. So if you want the overarching argument of this sermon, it's going to be that the gospel is the greatest gift that he has given us, and that we should exercise no other gift more than that. And the fact is that he has given that gift to everybody. And I know a lot of times we think, like, if it's given to everybody, it diminishes the value of the gift. But in fact, the gift is therefore so valuable that he could not not give it to everyone. Right? Did I say not twice, like a double negative person? Okay. So that's prophecy. And then he's going to speak about tongues. And when he's talking about tongues, he's a missionary going through the world. And he is speaking to people that speak different languages. And therefore, he is using different languages as he shares the gospel with every nation, every tribe, every tongue of people that he comes in contact with. And he is using that. And the purpose of using that was a kingdom-focused purpose, so that they could hear the gospel, so that he could prophesy to them and hear the gospel, and they would be able to therefore confess their sins, turn, and follow Jesus themselves. Right? And that was the purpose of speaking in tongues, that God was giving Paul the ability to speak in other languages. Let's go into verse 5 and we'll continue on, because there's another use of tongues that I want to talk about a little bit as well, but it's not the main focus. So, all right, verse 5, and we'll pick it up there. Now, I want you all to speak in tongues. So understand the context of this. If Paul was writing this today, I don't believe he would say, I want you all to speak in tongues, because they're not as necessary as they once were. Right? I don't think he would write that. He might write, I wish you all to be influential. Like, maybe he would write that. You know, I'm not sure what gift he would put in this space, but I don't think it would be that one. This one was necessary because the gospel wasn't out there yet, right? We are streaming our service this moment on the internet. Say hi to our internet people. Hi, internet people. They're probably real, right? We are streaming right now to the internet. You can get the gospel wherever you are in the world. We were on an island in Costa Rica that had one car on it, and the rest were motorcycles or walking, and they had smartphones and better internet than I have at my house. Right? You can get the gospel anywhere on the planet right now, unless you live in like North Korea and China. Right? Where they actively seek to block that. So, and I can dive into that, but I do not have time. I'm already off notes. And all right, so now I want you all to speak in tongues, but even more to prophesy, even more to share the gospel. The one who prophesies is greater than the one who speaks in tongues, unless someone interprets so that the church may be built up. Now, brothers, if I come to you speaking in tongues, how will I benefit you unless I bring you some revelation or knowledge or prophecy or teaching? If even lifeless instruments such as a flute or a harp do not give distinct notes, how will anyone know what is played? And if the bugle, which you heard today, that was handy, right? And if the bugle gives an indistinct sound, who will get ready for battle? So with yourselves, if with your tongue you utter speech that is not intelligible, how will anyone know what is said? For you will be speaking into the air. There are doubtless many different languages in the world, and none is without meaning. But if I do not know the meaning of the language, I'll be a foreigner to the speaker, and the speaker a foreigner to me. All right, so the people of Corinth seem to have a preoccupation with this particular gift. Like, something about this particular gift, being able to speak in other languages, really caught their attention. And they got so preoccupied with it that they weren't preaching the gospel anymore. They were just trying to speak in tongues. And that became their preoccupation. And like I said, I don't think Paul would have written that to us today. I don't think that's our preoccupation. And he would have written something different. But what happens is, many times, when we exercise our giftings, is we can become, and we're preoccupied by the gift and not by the Lord, and we're preoccupied by the gift and we're not preaching the gospel with it, we're not building up the church, and we become so wrapped up in that thing that we begin to get glory from it and not Jesus, right? And we begin to steal glory from God, because that's my gift. It ain't your gift. It was given to you by the Lord. So, you know, I've had this conversation with my kids at my house, right? You know, Simon will be playing with a toy that we got him for his birthday. And Annie will come and play with it and be like, no, that's mine. I'm like, actually, hold up. It's mine. That belongs to me, because we bought it for you, and we're letting you use it. which means she gets to use it, right? Have you ever been there? You ever had that talk with your children? That literally nothing belongs to you, right? Your clothes, your bed, like literally everything that you touch is mine, right? And we will begin to see the gifts that God gave us, not as his for us to serve him with, but as ours for us to be glorified in. And that, you know, you've derailed. Right? So we put this in context with no common language and with the people desiring to hear the gospel but not having someone to preach to them. So, of course, this gift, the Spirit being able to give you the ability to understand one another, mattered. Like, there's no other way to explain why the gospel spread through the breadth of the world except for this. Not with the speed that it did. And there's another one. Many people will pray in a language they don't understand. Have you heard of this? Say yeah, if you have. They'll pray in a tongue. Now, I'm going to encourage you in this. The Apostle Paul's writing this. If we speak intelligibly, we are just speaking to the air, right? We just heard him say that. Did you hear that? If you pray and outflows from you language that you don't understand, stop it. It's not doing you any good. There needs to be understanding. You need the spirit and the mind. Paul's going to dig into that in a minute. The spirit and the mind working in tandem. If you don't understand, stop. It's not good, okay? It just flows out of me. We'll unflow it. Like, you got to figure out how to stop that because you need self-control. We are talking about using the gifts of God in order, right? And there's an order to the way that we engage with God's Spirit. And he will not speak through you in ways that you won't understand. He does talk about praying in such a way when you don't have words for it, but you still understand what you're trying to get to, right? Like, I understand what I want, I just don't know how to articulate that, and sometimes the Spirit of God will speak in that, right? Not trying to be weird, like, come on, that's real, it's in the Bible, right? But if you are just, words are coming out and you're like, I have no idea what they mean, don't do that. If you have understanding, great, continue on, but if not, don't speak it. And a prayer language that you do privately, because you know, I know people that have prayed that way, and they say, like, well, yeah, I understand what I'm saying, but if I were to hear it, I wouldn't. But they understand, right? So this is a space that it's difficult for us. And then, of course, there's human language where we see most of the tongues in Scripture talked about is that people would be able to communicate with others. Go over to the book of Acts if you have your Bible open still. Acts chapter 2, and I'll show you this. When the day of Pentecost arrived, they were all together in one place. Verse 2. And suddenly there came from heaven a sound like a mighty rushing wind, and it filled the entire house where they were sitting, and divided tongues as of fire appeared to them and rested one on each of them. And they were all filled with the Holy Spirit, and they began to speak in other tongues as the Spirit gave them utterance. Now catch how that was perceived, right? Now there were dwelling in Jerusalem Jews, devout men from every nation under heaven. And at this sound, the multitude came together, and they were bewildered. Each one was hearing them speak in his own language, and they were amazed and astonished, saying, are not all these who are speaking Galileans? And how is it that we hear each of us in his own native language? And then it goes through a whole bunch of different countries that the people were from, hearing in different languages. And it goes on, verse 12, and they were all amazed and perplexed, saying to one another, what does this mean? So what we see is that many times in Scripture, when he talks about speaking in tongues, it wasn't some weird heavenly language. It was speaking in someone else's language for the purpose of building up the body of Christ and sharing the gospel, right? that it always had the purpose of building up the body. And this is how the gospel was spread through the entirety, the length and the breadth of the world, that people could understand. And like I said, this gift isn't as necessary as it once was. It still is. There's still spaces that we see this happen. You know, people get down into the jungles of the Amazon or somewhere in Africa where people have literally never seen a person with white skin before. And they will speak to the, and they'll be able to speak to those people. We see it happen today. But there's almost always someone nearby that can speak a common language. But just because those gifts are going away does not mean the greater gift of the Word of God and the truth of Jesus Christ and the gospel didn't disappear. And that's the gift we should desire. We should desire and seek after and foster in ourselves and build up in ourselves the ability to share the gospel with people that we meet. Because that's a greater gift, isn't it? And many times we see folks that speak in tongues or claim to speak in tongues doing so outside of the boundaries of God's word. And that ends up becoming nonsense, speaking for our own gratification. So when we say prophecy, I don't want you to hear, seize into the future. I want you to hear that idea of the gospel. Does that make sense? Sharing the gospel. It's not the lady down the street that, like, has a crystal ball, right? And is going to tell you this. Here's what she's going to say. You lost someone close to you. Right, like, we just went through a pandemic. Everyone lost someone close to them. Like, you could shake her out of a deep sleep and she could give you that one, right? That's not what we're talking about. What we're talking about is sharing the word of God as it was written in the Old and New Testament. All right, going on. 1 Corinthians 14, verse 12. All right. So with yourselves, since you are eager for manifestations of the Spirit, strive to excel in what? Building up the church. You're eager for gifts of God. You're eager for the spiritual gifts. Strive for this one, building up the church. Right? This is the one we should be working towards. Not healing, not tongues, not all these other great gifts that we see from God. Like, listen, let me tell you this. As a pastor, I feel like it would be very useful to be able to raise the dead. I could just find all kinds of application for that in my daily life, right? If I had that gift, and this is where I will always call out that healing charlatan that's down the street at the big stadium charging you $110 to come inside, right? I'm always going to call him out, because why are you at a stadium and not a hospital if you can heal, right? So let's just walk down to the ER and just see what happens, right? Yeah. Anyway, get off my soapbox for a minute. I just could see a lot of usefulness for that. Couldn't you? What, this past week I did 3 funerals. Or the past 2 weeks, something like that. I could find a lot of use for that gift. But what he's saying is the greatest gift we have is building up the church. And that's the one to exercise. That's the one that we're to seek to use. Where did I stop? I can't remember where I stopped. 13. All right, thank you. Therefore, why are you laughing at me, Amy? I don't understand. Therefore, the one who speaks in a tongue should pray that he may interpret. For if I pray in a tongue and my spirit prays, but my mind is unfruitful, right? So when I said earlier about, like, hey, if you're going to pray in some earthly language, but your mind can't perceive what that is, that's no good. It's unfruitful, right? Verse 15, what am I to do? I will pray with my spirit, but I will pray with my mind also. I will sing praise with my spirit, but I will sing praise with my mind also. Otherwise, if you give thanks with your spirit, how can anyone in the position of an outsider say amen to your thanksgiving when he does not know what you're saying? For you may be giving thanks well enough, but the other person is not being built up. I thank God that I speak in tongues more than all of you. Nevertheless, in church, I would rather speak 5 words with my mind in order to instruct others than 10,000 words in a tongue. So what he's trying to point us towards is the greatest thing we can do if we're going to exercise our gift is build up the church, and that we should constantly be seeking to build up the church. If you want to see manifestations of the Spirit of God in the church, I'll tell you what it looks like. It's not going to look like gifts and healings and power and signs and wonders. That's not what it's going to look like. The manifestation of the Spirit of God in the church is going to look like unity. When the Spirit is alive in a church, it's unified. That's the manifestation of power of the Spirit of God. And that's what that looks like. You know, it's not when people go crazy and fall out and yell and shout and do backflips down the aisle. Now, you do a backflip down the aisle, I'm going to be impressed, okay? But that's not manifestations of power of the Spirit of God. The manifestation of God's power is unity. It will always lead to that. The gifts of God will never divide us. If it divides, it's not a gift from God. And we read, you know, we read through Genesis, and you come to the Tower of Babel. How were the people divided? What were they divided by? What? By language, right? By their speech, by their tongues, right? They were divided into languages. And what we have that unifies us is the gospel of Jesus Christ. We come together from different backgrounds and different giftings and different usefulnesses. We come together around one thing, the gospel of Jesus Christ. And that's what binds us together. It's what holds us together. And it's what brings unity to the church body. The gospel of Jesus Christ is our unifying factor. And we're to be encouraged and built up by one another. That is what the giftings are given to. They are endowed to us differently and distinctly for the purpose of unifying and building up the body of Jesus Christ. And if they aren't doing that, they aren't gifts. And if we exercise these things in a manner for our own gratification, we are dividing the body. We are divided even in ourselves. So we're going to dig into the order by which gifts are to be used and get kind of a little bit of a rubber meets the road type of talk through this. So we are actually good on time. All right, let's get going. If you think about using your giftings as a part of the body, think about it this way. And Paul talked about this a little bit with musical notes. Like a musical note is just... it's just one note. It's kind of the smallest piece of music, right? But it's pretty meaningless unless it's in the right place within a melody, right? Which needs to be in its right place within the harmony, which needs to be in its right place within a movement, which then creates a symphony, right? But if you have one note out of place, you can tell it, right? You ever been listening to something and you heard it wrong? You're like, oh, that's not right. Anyone have that ear? Yeah, some of you? Anyone, you're like, I have no idea. It could be completely wrong and I'd have no clue. Like, yeah, I'm with you on that. If it's not written on the paper, I can't play it. But there's an order to it. For it to come out right, it's got to be in order. It's got to be in its proper place. It's got to be used correctly, right? And God set up this order so that the church wouldn't fall into disorder and therefore division. But he built it so that it, when working together, it unifies and comes together. So verse 20, let's pick it up there. Brothers, do not be children in your thinking. Be infants in evil, but in your thinking be mature. In the law it's written, by people of strange tongues and by the lips of foreigners will I speak to this people. And even then, They will not listen to me, says the Lord. Thus, tongues are a sign not for believers, but for unbelievers, while prophecy is a sign not for unbelievers, but for believers. If, therefore, the whole church comes together and all speak in tongues and outsiders or unbelievers enter, will they not say that you are out of your minds? Oh, they will. Yeah. Yeah. But if all prophecy, speak the word of God, I'll preach the gospel, and an unbeliever or an outsider enters, he is convicted by all, and he is called to account by all, and the secrets of his heart are disclosed, and so falling on his face, he will worship God and declare that God is really among you. Now, I know anytime we talk about things like this, the spiritual gifts and speaking in tongues and stuff, like we sound a little cultish, and we're not a cult, I promise you. Like, we do drink a lot of Kool-Aid, but we're not. I think that's just because we have a lot of kids here, and I don't think that's for cultish reasons. We don't play with snakes or do anything crazy, right? We're just a regular church, right? But these things do exist, and I think for a long time that the church has avoided this topic because, like I said, we've seen it done so poorly, we're afraid to exercise it. And the argument that our friend, the Apostle Paul, is making is, no, don't be afraid of this. Engage with it. Just do it the right way, right? So for us, if we're going to engage in something, let us engage in preaching the gospel. And I don't know what gift it is that commands your attention. Like maybe the gift that commands your attention is the gift of making money. Like, that's a gift, isn't it? Like, we all know some people that if they sneeze towards something, it pays them. You know what I'm talking about? You know where I'm at? Like, everything they step on turns to gold. You know where I'm at? Like, there's just people that are blessed like that. That's a gift from God. Use it for the furtherance of the gospel, right? Or some of it's like that gift of, I'd mentioned that gift of influence. I think if Paul was to write, like, everybody on the planet today wants to be an influencer, don't they? And like 92.8% of those people shouldn't be influencing, like, I don't know, a kite. Like, they shouldn't have any influence over anything, right? But everybody wants to influence somebody. I think that'd be a gift that Paul would point out. Because that is a gift, isn't it? Maybe the gift of intelligence, the gift of hospitality, whatever gift it is that kind of grabs your heart. How can I use this to propel the greater gift of the gospel of Jesus Christ? How can I use this to build up the church? How can I use this to create unity within the body? And using our gift sets to build the church of Jesus. And people are smart, right? Like, you start presenting a message that doesn't make sense, they're going to catch that. Unless they're in Hollywood and then Scientology, like, where'd that junk come from? I don't even know. Like who buys into that unless you're Tom Cruise, right? But if an unbeliever were to come in here and we're all chanting some weird language, how long before they leave? Right? Did we build up the body? Did we encourage anyone? Did we see the gospel go forth? No, we didn't. But if someone who doesn't know Jesus comes in here and they hear about how Jesus lovingly and graciously sacrificed his life for them so that they could take on his righteousness and he would take on their sin and he would wipe their slate clean so that they could spend eternity with him, man, that hits, doesn't it? Man, that catches your heart, doesn't it? And they hear like, hey, you're a sinner, but that's paid for by the blood of Jesus Christ. That's going to catch them different. And it's a mark to other believers, like, because it should be. Because if you hear the gospel being preached in half, or you hear the gospel being manipulated by those who would just seek to draw a crowd, we can catch that, can't we? If we know the truth. So the gospel is preached to draw people into the presence of Christ. What's a better gift? What's better, right? Preaching in tongues or... just give you an example of this. I heard a story of a guy that was going to college and he heard about a tongues meeting at a church where they're all going to get together and talk weird languages and do crazy stuff. All right, So that's what he hears about. So he shows up and speaks the mass, the Catholic Mass in Latin, which is beautiful. Have you ever heard it? Like, it's beautiful, isn't it? Like, some of my Catholic friends, like, you speak the Mass in Latin. It's gorgeous, right? And this guy stands up to interpret and says something off the wall. And the guy's like, actually, that's the Mass in Latin, and I just spoke it to, like, prove that you guys are kind of being crazy. And they asked him to leave. Right? So as opposed to be confronted with the fact that I have stepped outside of the boundaries of God's word in this thing, we'll just get this guy out of here so we can keep doing what we want. Right? We force it. We make it do something it's not designed to do. The gifts of God were not designed to increase your glory. They were meant for the glory of God. So, all right, let's finish this chapter out. Talk about how we use our giftings. Orderly worship. Paul's going to walk us through the nuts and bolts of that. Verse 26. What then, brothers? When you come together, each one has a hymn and a lesson and a revelation and a tongue or an interpretation. Let all things be done for building up. So this is kind of rule number one for using our gifts in the church. Are we using them to build up the body? Are we being used to build the body of Christ better? Are we serving the body? Because that's what we started out with, right? The gifts are a capacity to serve. That's all they are. They're not something mystical. It's a capacity to serve. So are we building up the body of Christ? Anything we do has to pass through that filter. Am I doing it for me or the body of Christ? Because if it's for me, I better not do it. And if it's for the body of Christ, then it's good for the body. And I would pull other people in. Honestly, tell me, am I using this thing for my glory or for God's? And let them speak to you honestly. Because isn't it amazing how quickly selfishness can take over something good? Isn't it amazing how quickly how we can convince ourselves that our selfishness is selfless? You ever notice this? You ever had a relative pass away and like some family member from God knows where that you've never met shows up and starts going through the jewelry and carrying furniture out because it's what grandma wanted? Right? You ever been there? And they're just selflessly taking all this stuff, right? We've seen it, haven't we? We've seen selfishness be labeled selfless, and it's not. So have someone in your life that's willing to tell you that. And convince you and walk you through giving glory to the Lord and not yourself. Are we doing what we do, first of all, for the building up of the body? Let it pass through that filter. Verse 27. If any speak in a tongue, let there be only two or at most three, and each in turn, and let someone interpret. But if there is no one to interpret, let each of them keep silent in church and speak to God, or speak to himself, sorry, and to God. So this is where I said, don't do too much. Like, don't push the envelope so far, and don't push back. Like do things in order, do things in moderation. Sometimes less is more, isn't it? And so a while back when I lived in Virginia, I went to a church service with a friend, and they sang, I wanted somewhere between seven and eight songs, something like that. We were standing for like an hour, just singing before the service started. Like, that's a long time, right? I sat down. I was like, I'm sorry, I'm out. I don't remember what the preacher said. I don't remember what he looked like. I couldn't even drive you to the church today. I was like, I was on the edge of leaving, right? Because like it didn't build me up. It exhausted me. Does that make sense? And it exhausted the church. Like, you could see it in the band. They were bored. They're like, all right, we'll play another one. You know, like, but the worship leader was using his gift, right? It didn't build up the body, it weakened it, right? Don't do too much. Too many times we throw things into confusion and not order. Too many times we bring fear and we don't bring the power of the Spirit of God into preaching the gospel of Jesus Christ. And many times we rely more on experience than we do the presence of God. Oh, I could really feel the Spirit there. Did you? Right? Verse 29. So don't make sure that what you're doing is building up the body too. Don't do too much. Don't let it be too much. And then in verse 29 he says, when I find it, let two or three prophets speak and let the others weigh what was said. If a revelation is made to another sitting there, let the first be silent. For you can prophesy one by one so that all may learn and all be encouraged. And the spirits of the prophets are subject to prophets. That's an important phrase. For God is not a God of confusion, but of peace. So what he's talking about here is having healthy discussion and dialogue. Like, so we just opened the Word of God and we just went through 1 Corinthians 14, which is a weighty chapter. We should talk about it. Like, when we go downstairs and have coffee, we should talk about it. When you go home, you should talk about it in the car ride home. You should call your friends and you should talk. Like, we should be constantly speaking of the things of the Lord. So we make sure that we're building up the body. We make sure that we're not doing too much, that we're not overpowering the people. And then we have healthy discussion around it to bring understanding, to bring knowledge, to bring different perspectives. And we draw people into closer communion with the Lord through conversation. That's an important piece. Too many of us sit in church and consume without ever giving back. Have healthy discussions. Verse 33, let's finish up. For God is not a God of confusion, but of peace. As in all the churches of the saints. This is where we get in trouble, right? The women should keep silent in the churches, for they're not permitted to speak. No one respond to that, okay? But should be in submission, as the law also says. If there's anything they desire to learn, let them ask her husband at home, for it is shameful for a woman to speak in church. All right, blessed be the word of the Lord. All right. Let's talk about what's going on in this moment in history, okay? Here's what was happening. Up until now, up until this moment that Paul's writing this, women were not permitted into the inner courts of the temple and therefore weren't learning the word of God. Like, they could be in the outer courts where women were permitted, but they weren't permitted in the inner parts of the church. Now they are. In Christ, that door's been opened, and women are now learning alongside of men, equals with men. So before our feminist friend's hair catches fire, like, just understand that Jesus brought unity, and he brought equality, right? Okay, so this is where they're at. What was happening was that the women in the church didn't understand what was being taught because they hadn't been taught the earlier stuff. So they're asking questions, and they're shouting those questions at the teacher, who then can't teach because he's fielding all these questions. And you know how it goes when one question gets asked and you answer it, now two more have popped up in its place, right? So here he is trying to field all these questions, and all he's saying is, maybe don't shout out in the middle of church and ask your husband who can tell you, because he's been there, right? He knows, let him teach it. If you don't have a husband that can teach you, ask someone else, but don't shout out in the middle of the teaching. It's not anti-woman, it was just saying that was the group that was doing that. Okay, does that make sense? You still don't like me. All right, so this is... So all he's asking them to do is not shout out and to interrupt, but to let someone teach. And if you have questions, listen, didn't he just a couple verses prior say, let's make sure we're having healthy discussion? Like, let's make sure we're talking about these things? There's a time and a space for it. And that moment isn't the time for questions. Leave it for the time of discussion. All right. Verse 36, or was it from you that the word of God came? Or are you the only one it has reached? If anyone thinks that he's a prophet or spiritual, he should acknowledge that the things I am writing to you are a command of the Lord. If anyone does not recognize this, he's not recognized. So my brothers, earnestly desire to prophesy and to not forbid speaking in tongues, but all things should be done decently and in order. So we make sure we're building up the body of Christ. We make sure that we're not doing too much, that we're doing things in a reasonable amount. We make sure we're having healthy discussions. We don't ask, we don't use the moment inappropriately. We make sure we're being appropriate for the moment that we're in. And then we do everything in humility. And this is the order by which we must follow the Spirit of God. Don't allow yourself to inflate your opinion to the of yourself, right? Because this is one of the dangers of the gifts, is that we inflate our own opinion of ourselves. And God gave those to you to use for his glory, not your own. And the greatest gift he gave us is the gospel. The greatest gift that he handed us is the gospel of Jesus Christ, that we can share that with a world that is dying of its sin. And we can see some saved. That's the greatest gift that we have. If we get so preoccupied with the signs and wonders, we forget the gospel. And that's what makes it, the greatest gift. It's the tongues won't save you, but the gospel does, right? So let's make sure we're exercising that. And we've all been given the gospel. And we all share the gospel. That's the gift we seek to exercise, if you're going to use one. Lord, we thank you for this opportunity to worship you this morning. I pray that as we continue on and we move through our holiday, Lord, that you are going to put us into contact with humans we don't normally have contact with. So I pray that you would give us chances just to say, you know, Jesus has been good to us, or here's how I've been blessed lately, or, I'm thankful for my freedoms, and it's all come from the hand of Christ. And Lord, just give us these opportunities in small ways to speak your word to the world around us. And Lord, maybe you'll give us the ability to speak it in the language of the people we're with so that they'll understand. We love you, Jesus. And thank you for all that you're doing for us and all you'll continue to do. In your name we pray, amen. Stand with us as we will close out with a few songs.
I hear the rolling thunder.
we close our worship out, I'd invite you to sing together with us. We're going to do one more song, and that song is called the Doxology. Now, it's not old-fashioned, it's timeless. And that's because as God continues to bless us, it is good for our hearts to hand that blessing back to Him, knowing that it came from Him to begin with. So let's sing together, if you would. Our Savior, we thank you for the time we had together, and that we'll continue to give you the honor and glory that you are due in all the spaces that we go and all the places we find ourselves. Just carry with us, if you would, a willingness and a hunger to glorify you, to make your gospel known among the nations so that more souls can come to salvation, can come to healing and wholeness, but most of all can come to a relationship and a life of presence with you. We love you, Jesus. In your name we pray. Amen. Off. Have a seat real quick, and I got a couple announcements. So our next game is on the 5th, that's Tuesday. So if you can, try and show up around 5. We want to get a little bit of practice in on our field because we need it. So, so that's the plan, and we're going to give that a try on the field that we play on. Give us a little, hopefully, some advantage. Then we have the sale on from the 7th to the 9th, so kind of be aware of that. That's Thursday, right? Thursday through Saturday? Thursday, Friday, Saturday. Yeah, so be there for that. That's out at Leanne's house on 861 near Squirrel Hill. We'll have signs up, though, to help get you there. If you need the address, see Leanne. She'll get you there. And then July 11th through the 15th is our VBS every night from 5:30 to 8. So if you have kids or you know kids that need to be signed up, go ahead and get them signed up now so that we know how many are coming. We can do food prep and all that stuff and get the final pieces in place. And then the week after, the 17th through the 22nd is our kids camp down at Little Mahoning Camp. We partner with Zion and First Baptist Church and another church in Pittsburgh. And we are doing a joint camp that we're very excited about bringing kids in. If you haven't got your kids signed up, go ahead and do that. If money is an issue, give us a holler and we'll get them there. We'll make sure it happens. All right, is that it? Yes.
I would like to say we are not having choir for the whole month of July. The elementary choir.
Okay. Oh, yeah, we know. All right, first week of August, if you're, was it 3rd through 6th, you said?
Yes.
3rd through 6th grade, if they're starting a little band. So get your 3rd through 6th grader in there. Anything else that we missed? All right, head downstairs. We have coffee and cookies and all kinds of fruit and stuff. Help yourselves, and we'll see you down there.